Hey everyone, it's Jim.
And Charles.
From Valves & More, an online vintage tube store. And today in Tube Lab number 187, we're going to take a look at the Soviet 6N3P2. But first, caution everyone, electronics and tube amplifiers can have very high voltages present, which can be lethal. Exercise extreme caution when working around them. Always consult a professional technician when in doubt. Well, before we get going with today's Tube Lab, just a little bit of housekeeping. We've been trying to find a good balance of shipping speed and efficiency, and it looks like Monday and Thursday work best. Most of your orders come in on Friday and Saturday, so nothing is really going to change for 90% of you. Also, when placing an order, take your time. Make an account, make sure you've ordered the correct tubes or socket adapters. These days, a lot of tubes we sell need adapters to work. And after you've filled in your cart, take a few minutes and double check if you have everything you need. If you have any questions, please message us before you order. We normally reply really quickly to all correspondence. Well, lately we've been seeing more demand for a tube we even forgot we had inventory for. And that tube is the Soviet 6N3P. And the reason we're seeing a revival of interest is thanks to inexpensive Chinese tube amps that have started using this tube. Now, the Chinese have their own version called the 6N3, modeled after the Soviet version. Almost everyone who owns a Chinese amp ends up asking us if we have a better equivalent. And I'm happy to say we do. And that's the subject of today's episode. Well, Charles, what have you got for us?
Okay, well, we really only have one version of the tube in large quantities, but I did manage to find another Soviet-produced version to show off here, and it is a little bit different. So let's start off, first of all, with this guy over here, which is the one we actually have quite a number of. And actually, we're going to start with the box, because just look at that. Beautiful yellow and blue, and you'll never guess where these were made. In Ukraine. These were actually made in the Oktyabr, which is just October plant, and that is to the southwest of Kyiv. Likely named for the October Revolution in Russia, which is something that they commonly did whenever they were naming factories. They would name them after historical events or important people. I believe one of them that we reviewed before in East Germany was the Ansikers plant or something like that. It was another famous political person in Russia.
Right. In Germany.
In Germany, yeah.
Well, East Germany.
East Germany. Yeah. Probably you could just say the Soviet Union at the time. And here's the tube. And what we're looking at here, let me see if I can get some better light on that, is 9-pin dual triode with a mu close to that of something like a 6DJ8 or a 6N1P. So it's a very similar tube. And
it's got a weird logo, doesn't it?
Yeah, take a look at that. The logo, I believe, is meant to stylize a rocket launching off from a planet and then going into orbit around it, which is something that you see commonly with a lot of Soviet tubes from this era. Everybody wanted to jump on the space race bandwagon.
And many of the
Nuclear too, if you take a look at the box art.
Right. And many of the tubes were actually probably being used in some component of the space program.
So. Yeah. Yeah, it's certainly possible. Anyway, so this guy is really similar to a 6N1P or 6DG8, but there are some important differences to it. It was designed as a mid to high frequency amplifier and as an oscillator and was used in a lot of radio systems. It also has a different pinout, and arguably, I think the pinout is superior, and it's divided right down the middle, similar to how Sylvania did loctal tubes. So you have exactly one half the tube over here, and the other half over here with a shield on the center pin.
Which is pin 5.
Pin 5, and I'll show you that on the data sheet in just a second here. The really neat thing you can do with that is that you could mount a socket on either side of a PCB and still have the tube work, which is just really cool. Let's take a look at the box first. Is this a reflector?
Yes.
Yeah, this is a reflector box for the 6N3PE, and this is the EV version. And we've got some more of that great Soviet box art. They definitely had a style. And these were, where was the original reflector plant?
Saratov. In fact, it's still in Saratov, Russia, and mm-hmm. it's now the new sensor plant that makes that makes like 90% of modern tubes that are available for sale. All those reissues of Mullards and Svetlanas, and anyways.
So they've been around for quite some time, yeah.
Yeah, and to be honest with you, if I had a choice between any other plant and reflector, I would take
any other plant.
Yeah.
The Oktyabr plant in particular was actually known for making very good small signal tubes and 9-pin tubes. And in our testing of them, that really shows through. They tested remarkably close on their sections, which is not something that these tubes are particularly known for, and tested very tight matches.
Yeah, and of course the plant would have been set up by Soviet technicians mm-hmm. and would have essentially been a Soviet plant, even though it was operating in the Ukraine.
Yep, and this is the -E version, so you can see we have a little bit of a different construction here. The plates are very similar, a little bit different, and we have an extra stiffening mica at the top here. So that's pretty neat. Let's take a quick look at the data sheet. Let's see if we can get this on screen properly. So let me grab my poker here.
Now the original version of this tube was made in the US, wasn't it?
It was, and it was actually made by a company that is fairly famous nowadays for making fantastic vacuum tubes, Western Electric.
Ah, and Western Electric has a really interesting history. Western Electric was the manufacturing and the research division of Bell Telephone, which later became AT&T. And who started Bell Telephone? Alexander Graham Bell, of course. So it has quite an illustrious history. And a lot of research and development that established all kinds of standard tubes came mm-hmm. out of Western Electric. So they did a lot of amazing electrical and technical development.
Yeah, and the original version of this tube was copied by basically everybody. There was a U.S. Number designated version, which I think is used for industrial tubes, called the 5670. The Europeans made the 2C51, which is another direct equivalent. And then, of course, the Soviets made the 6N3P and all its subversions, and the Chinese made the 6N3.
Yeah, and we won't say anything more about the Chinese version. Okay, what does the data sheet for the Soviet version say? And we couldn't find the EV version.
So we're working off the E1, but they're going to be very similar.
And what do they mean? The E stands for?
Extended ratings. So typically that means it'll have a longer filament life, it'll have tighter specifications on it.
And if we add the V?
It'll be vibration and more ruggedized. Sorry, vibration resistant and more ruggedized.
Yeah, essentially, I think the main function of that is high G, right?
Yeah.
So it's probably for aircraft and rockets and missiles.
And the -E is actually a little more ruggedized than the standard one if you compare the data sheets. This can handle higher impacts and more vibration than the standard one.
Yeah, and as a general rule with Soviet tubes, in most cases, if you can get it, you want the E or the EV version. Sometimes they were never made an E or EV version, but if there is one, you would almost always prefer to get that.
Yeah,
it's essentially equivalent to the Western mil-spec version.
Yeah, and it can make a huge difference in some cases, especially for this tube here. The standard version of it has a service life of 1,500 hours for the filament. The E and the EV version, 5,000 hours. So it's over three times the amount of life that you can get out of one of these tubes, which is a huge difference.
And an average Western tube typically would have a 2,000 hour filament. So 5,000 mm-hmm. is crazy.
Yeah, very long lived. So we can see the tube pinout here. Unfortunately, this isn't the nicer, larger Soviet version we normally see, but you should be able to make it out just fine. And you can see that mirrored structure here where we have the one half the filament, the cathode, a grid, and an anode all on one side, and then the same mirrored on the other with a shield down the middle. And I just love seeing tubes that were built this way. I think it means the designers of it were thinking about how the electrical engineers were going to be implementing these. They wanted to keep it simple, flexible. People could easily remember these pinouts.
And the interesting thing is that improved designs of tubes or second generation versions that got new numbers will often go to the symmetrical layout. But the earlier versions of virtually everything that was designed is all over the place.
Yeah, everybody had their own standards and ways of doing things. And sometimes we got stuck with that over the years.
Yeah.
So we see we've got a standard 6.3 volt heater, which is common of, I'd say, probably 95% of Soviet tubes. They loved the standardize on 6.3 volts. And that means it's also compatible with all the American and European versions. And we've got that amplification factor of 34, plus or minus 8 or 9, or 6, which is also something you commonly see on Soviet data sheets. It's interesting that they put that in there, and I think that is dependent on the operating point of where you're running the tube, not the variance in the manufacturing. Could you imagine if they varied this much on the amplification factor across a production run? It would be incredible.
Right, okay, so that makes sense.
And if we go to the back of the sheet here, we're going to see the maximum power handling, which is a little bit lower than something like a 6N1P, which is probably one of the closer equivalents of this tube. So it's a bit lower powered, but it was really just designed for voltage amplification.
Yeah.
And as a result, it actually has some advantages over the 6N1P, such as lower inter-electrode capacitances, which are really important whenever you're amplifying higher frequencies.
Yeah, essentially, you don't want one of the electrodes in either stage.
We're losing focus here. Come on. There we go.
You don't want the capacitance to be so high that various electrodes can interfere with each other.
Yeah. Yeah, interact with each other. There's actually something that can happen where your signal essentially gets reflected back as feedback onto the grid. And you definitely don't want that happening.
Oh, scary. No, we don't.
Okay, so we've had a look at the tubes. Why don't we go have a quick listen to them, and then we'll pop back in and see what we've had come in.
Life goes on.
wow. Well, Charles, you've listened to these quite a bit because you listen to them when you clear them for noise.
I was
clearing
a whole bunch of them and listening to all sorts of music, and I was really impressed by the sound. They are a great sounding tube, and I wasn't expecting that for something that is available in such large quantities.
Well, one of the interesting things about tubes that are designed to operate at high frequencies, but the data sheet, I don't think we showed you, but the data sheet clearly shows that they operate from 5 hertz up to, do you remember how high? Anyways, they go way up into the stratosphere, way beyond the audio range, is that they tend to perform really well in the audio band.
Yep.
Just because the spec of manufacturing to get into the high frequencies makes them better suited to handle low frequencies.
Yeah, it works for that as well.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's interesting. And you found some fabulous tubes that are really high demand. And
we've been having trouble keeping any of them in stock.
Now, they're branded Raytheon, but in fact, these are the Toshibas. Made in Japan, 6CG7s.
Yep.
And they are essentially a tall miniature 9-pin version or direct electrical equivalent of the 6SN7.
Mm-hmm. And people have been raving about these tubes.
Yeah. And personally, I'm listening actually to a close cousin of this. We were listening last night, or maybe it was the night before. Last night was dinner out for both of us, to the RCA Cleartop 6GU7,
mm-hmm, which has great example of
a little bit warmer sound. But these Toshibas, we've got some audiophile customers who are just totally in love with the sonics of these. They're very different than the 6SN7. Lower distortion, very clean, clear sound. But the thing about the Toshibas, I think they like quite a bit, is that the mid-range pops nicely.
Yeah.
And of course, 90% of your recorded music sits in the mid-range. So when you get the mid-range right, you're 90% there.
Mm-hmm. So we've been lucky enough to find some more new old stock and actually some used that are in the store at a better price but are still testing fantastic.
Now, if something's rebranded Raytheon and it's in fact a Toshiba, does that change the value of the tube?
Not at all.
Not at all. It's just, you know, so much rebranding happened over the years. We've tried to estimate how many tubes that were made, vintage tubes that were made and rebranded. And we think that maybe as many as half of all tubes ever manufactured were rebranded. So don't get fussed by a label. In fact, I know in modern society, a lot where we've been sort of geared towards looking at labels and recognizing brand names and thinking that makes quality. And you can't apply that to vintage tubes, or you're going to get really annoyed because you're going to get, you know, tubes from us. You'll get a Raytheon and a Toshiba. If they match electrically and are identical tubes, and this is a matched pair, that's, you know, the tubes are getting so scarce that that's electrical parameters are always the key element that you're looking for. You want matched pairs. And of course, to get these into a 6SN7 socket, you need an adapter, and we sell those as well. And these have worked out really well.
Yeah, well, we've been surprised at the number we've been selling. I mean, they're a great adapter for all sorts of different tubes to bring them into a 6SN7 socket.
Yeah, we're actually running low, and I've got a huge order in. So the bank account's empty. But anyways, we sell a lot of socket adapters. Okay, up next, this week I spent a good chunk of the week manufacturing tubes. Wow. I started off with, hang on a second, I've got a Loctel hanging around here somewhere. So I started off with this. This is a Sylvania Loctel tube. Let's see if I can get it to focus a little bit better. There you go. This one here happens to be the 7F7, which is the equivalent to the 6SL7 GT. And let me get this out and show it to you. The components inside, all the electrical parts, are essentially identical. There's some minor variations depending on what year they were made. Anyways, we take the base off and we rebase these things, and it's a huge job. It's got many, many steps. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, we end up with a loctal tube rebased as an octal. And because we were able to find the loctal tube's new old stock in good quantity, good matches, high testing tubes, 80 for a 6SL7 is a new old stock tube. Anyways, these sound amazing. These sound, I think, better than the standard 6SL7s. We also have the 6SN7 version, and we're almost out of these.
Yeah, actually, for a while we did run out of them. This is the very last version equivalent, so this is equivalent to the 6SN7 GTBs. You can tell by the lighter chrome dome that are on them here. And we ran out of them completely, but we're able to find some more to rebase and get back into the store.
And we have almost all of the generations of the Sylvania 6SL7s and 6SN7s as loctals rebased, including some very early first versions,
yep,
going back to the mid to late 30s and 40s,
mm-hmm,
which is crazy that you can still find those tubes new old stock. So they're a bitch to rebase, but the Sonics make it well worthwhile.
Yep.
Okay, what else have we got, Charles?
Okay, now in the category of things that we found that we forgot that we had, I found some interesting tubes while digging around in our stock over the last few days, and I thought you'd like to see them. So we're going to start off over here with these absolutely beautiful RCA Silvertone branded 45s. And the 45s are a direct heated power triode. They're getting really rare these days. We don't have a lot of them floating around. And there are some amps that run these. Apparently they're fantastic sounding, but we don't have anything we can listen to them in.
Yeah, people are running them in SET or Class A.
SET is single-ended triode mode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and these, of course, are single triodes.
Mm-hmm. Now, these, we have them in the stores used. We don't have boxes for them. It's possible that they were actually new old stock, but we can't know for sure.
So we call them used.
Mm-hmm.
Good
but,
used.
But they are testing exactly where they should for new old stock, 40 and 38 milliamps, and
the chrome is amazing.
Yeah, I mean, look at that. Like, for a tube that's this old.
Yeah, and Silvertone was the... it was the marketing brand name of Sears.
Mm-hmm.
And Sears, for much of their electronics life, wanted high quality products. So, of course, they went to RCA. A lot of the tubes that ended up rebranded Silvertone came out of RCA.
Yep. And we found something else really interesting. This is a 12SL7. So not something you're going to be able to run in just about any amp, but a fantastic tube because we've got a black glass tongue saw. And you can tell by those back-to-back thin round plates. And let me see if I can get that label up on screen here. And this one is triangle branded. Where is that label hiding? It's very faint on this one. Oh, well, not going to be able to find it. But as a 6SL7 tube, these are so incredibly rare and hard to find. But as a 12SL7, they're not difficult. Well, I guess they are still difficult to find, but you can actually find them.
You can actually find them. Yeah, and of course, our universal kit phono preamp takes the 6-volt version and...
and the 12-volt version. So it will run these tubes, and they just sound amazing. We have a small number of them that were all from the same batch that had these really cool-looking boxes.
Do you think we've got matched pairs?
Oh, almost certainly, yeah. And
look at that box.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't even have... sorry, we're having problems with the focus today, apparently.
Well, it doesn't like a dead space in,
yeah,
which there's no action.
Yeah, it doesn't even have the triangle brand on the box here, which is kind of interesting. Maybe it's hiding somewhere inside. We have a number of these. I guess they were probably put in a couple of sleeves and stored away somewhere until today.
Yeah, well, I mean, one of your jobs is to keep track of the inventory so that we know where things are, because we have a huge inventory.
Yeah.
As you're going through things, your eyes are wandering to see what interesting stuff is hiding.
I say, oh, that looks neat. And then I check it out and say, oh, well, we have to get that in the store and we have to show it on camera.
Well, I think a month ago or so, you found those true Mueller DL84s that people have been snapping up.
Yep.
And they're not cheap tubes, but my goodness, they are not common tubes to find new old stock these days.
So it shows you the kinds of things that can slip under our radar for a while.
Yeah. And in a way, it's good because, you know, they're available today for people. Well, if you stayed this long, here's some discount codes to help you out. And people have been grabbing a secret code that's pretty easy to figure out if you just keep on going. And we can reach almost everybody with flat rate shipping of $20. And if your order is $150 or more after discount, the shipping's on us, folks. Stay safe, everyone. This is Jim.
And Charles.
Signing off. Cheers, everyone.